The thing that I love the most is just being with God's people on Sunday morning. We were singing from the Bible. We were singing the word of God to his people. The melody music was the tool to get it in my head and in my heart. It's so moving when our whole congregation is singing scripture together.
Welcome to Bible Memory Goal. My name is Josh, and you just heard from Adam Wright. He's the music director at Cahaba Park Church in Birmingham, Alabama, out of which there's a ministry called The Corner Room that I was first introduced to a few months ago that is just fantastic Bible-based music that you're going to love. You really ought to just look it up right now on Spotify, Apple Music, or wherever you listen to your music, maybe even here on YouTube, because it is great music. On top of doing that, Adam is also part of a band called Act of Congress that has traveled the world, that is associated with the State Department. And one of the things I wanted to ask him to start off with was, where has he been or what has he done that has been the most interesting to him to see?
The coolest and most terrifying place I've been is the Burj Khalifa in Dubai. To be up at that elevation in an enclosed space building is amazing until you look down. Because I'm not a big fan of heights. And looking up there, of course, they've got glass and a bar back behind that, so you can't get really close. But, I mean, Josh, you look down on the ground, and it looks like there's ants. I mean, it's unreal how tall that is.
I know.
Anyway, that was a pretty amazing experience. Petra would be the opposite of that. Like, just, you know, you hear people say all the time, like, you look at a picture, and if you see that in real life, it just, the picture doesn't do it justice. I mean, it's so true, because in Petra, you're surrounded by just these rocks, and it's just beautiful everywhere, and it's just amazing to behold. So anyway.
Yeah. I mean, I've traveled all over the world. Those are two places I haven't been yet, but I would love to go at some point. And did you go as like part of your Act of Congress band? Like, was that something that you guys were doing?
Both of those were with the band. A third I could think of was in Jordan as well. We got to play in like an ancient Roman Colosseum. Now, I'm not talking gladiator size, but like, I mean, it was amazing. And so I walked up where people would sit before we played. There's no handrail. Like, if you fall, you're a goner. You know, like, but it's just so cool to be in that historic place and site. I've been juggling for years. I was teaching private lessons for a while, playing with the band, started serving at the church, and I've been here for 15 years now. And then the Corner Room kind of came about in 2015, and that was another ball to juggle in the air. And so, I don't know, Josh, the older I get, I love the variety of getting to do lots and lots of different things under that musical umbrella. But I have really come to enjoy, you know, the band has gotten to travel the world and do some really cool things and play with symphonies and things like that. But the thing that I love the most, or one of my favorite things, is just being with God's people on Sunday morning on a very small local level. Like, I just love that. And just getting to use my gifts to serve one group of people over and over again every week. Like, I love that.
You mentioned the Corner Room, and this is kind of what I really want to be talking about, but tell us a little bit about why you started that and what that is.
Corner Room is one of those things that was, I didn't really see it coming, had zero, you know, aspiration of, you know, like, I graduated college, I'm going to go and do this thing. It was very much kind of a God providing an opportunity. It had all... The genesis was just serving this local church, Cahaba Park. We were doing a sermon series on the Psalms one summer, and I got to thinking, I plan the liturgy for our services here. And so I was trying to think about a way to bathe in the text before our pastor at the time would preach the text. And so I went to Google, and I was like, I wonder if anybody's ever tried to write, you know, musical settings of the Psalms. And I found a few things, but none of them that really just resonated with me. And so I thought, I'm just going to sit down and try it. And so I had Psalm 1 open on my bed with my notepad, my voice memos, and my guitar one night. And I was like, I'm gonna give this a shot and try it. And it was one of the most rich times in Scripture I've ever had. And so that evening, finished the Psalm 1 arrangement. The following Sunday, had it mapped out for the musicians, and we actually sang the psalm before Murray preached that text.
Blessed.
It was amazing. I remember one of Murray's observations that was so cool was, you know, when he looked over at the musicians, he didn't see music on our stands. The singers, we were singing from the Bible. Like, we were singing the word of God to his people. And so, yeah, I think that just kind of birthed in me. It helped me to see, not only helped me to think about memorizing scripture and meditating on it. I didn't even need the words by the time Sunday rolled around, because the melody, the music was the tool to get it in my head and in my heart. And so that kind of created this process of where is the church? What are we studying? And how can I use my gifts to help put the word in people's ears and in their mouths and in their hearts? And so every project I've done has been kind of a result of, you know, what our church is studying. We've done a 1 Corinthians 13 unit. So I did that chapter. Isaiah 53 was like a set of Good Friday meditations over the years that I did, and eventually had like a whole work to share. The kids project, I work very closely with our children's director here, and I'm always asking her, like, what are the passages that are going to serve our kids? And so, and she writes her own curriculum. So we were able to kind of work like, okay, I'll set this one in music and it's going to apply to this specific unit.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures.
All my decisions are based on how can I serve this church? And then if it goes out, and thankfully it has, I mean, you're an artist, you want the Lord to use your work and in bigger ways and for more people to hear it. And this is different because this is scripture. This isn't just me writing songs for me. This is like, Lord, use this to make your word known and make it more, more accessible.
And I think, you know, the way that I see it, at least from I was looking at Spotify, and, you know, you've got your band that does, you know, modest monthly listening, but the Corner Room, like, it is, for those of you guys who don't know, like, if you're not familiar with, like, the way that Spotify kind of shares how many listeners per month, and the Corner Room gets over 100,000 a month. You said beyond your church, unless your church is massive, like, that's a pretty good reach that the music is happening. Like, there's people that are listening to this all around the world, and that's got to, I don't know, that's got to be really encouraging to you to see that happening.
It is, and not from a notoriety perspective, but just
sure.
The fact that people are resonating with God's word. It's like, man, okay. I think the first part of it is there's an inner realization of, okay, Lord, you give me these gifts. I want to steward them well. And it does make me more passionate about that. But I think on the other hand, it's just, I get emails like people who are dealing with really, really, really hard things. And they'll tell me, you know, this song has just been such a balm to my soul in this particular season. Or, you know, I had a guy come to me at worship on Sunday, and he was just like, I've been listening to the Corner Room in my car all week long. I'm just so thankful for what you're doing. So that's what it's all about, sharing a good gift with people and hopefully the Lord using it to bring about more and more passion for him in the lives of his people.
I love that idea of our skill set, whatever it is that God's given us, being the vehicle through which we share something about our heart for God and you know, mm-hmm. yours and even mine, and this whole thing just being God's word and the beauty of God's word and my skill with you know, video and media production, and your skill with music. And I love seeing, because one of the things we were talking about before we started this is, you know, I went to Nashville for, you know, schooling. I don't know if I told you this, I went to Belmont. I studied music business, like, and I was in all the studios and all that stuff. And I love it when I hear like high quality music. And I'm not, it's not that I'm discouraged when I hear lower quality. It's more just like, I know that Adam, you are a very talented musician. And the work that you're putting out is not kind of subpar. Like, it is up there. And I think that's really neat to see people who have that level of skill set then using that, you know, in some way to glorify God. And so I just wanted to say thank you for doing that. It is really cool.
I really appreciate you saying that. And I love when people sometimes I'll put little, I'll call them Easter eggs, into the songs for people to hopefully pick up on. One of my favorite ones, and I think that adds to the layer of what you're talking about, that excellence layer, where I'm trying to think music production and the quality is good, but also like how can we, you know, dig in deeper into the text and try and pull out new truths from these amazing sacred words. At the end of Isaiah 53, that project, "With his wounds we are healed," it ends with, the project starts with, "Behold, my servant shall prosper. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted," which is like the prelude to 53. It's the last three verses of 52. And so we start the project with those words. And then I end it at the end with the same words, because Jesus is going to do that. He's fulfilled it. And then you hear 12 church bell tones that kind of, in our minds and in our the way we think about time, it's like the start of something new. It's like a new day, you know, for us. But this is something new that Jesus has fulfilled it, and he is doing something new. He's going to make all things new when he returns. And so that's one thing I really love as a songwriter, as someone who really appreciates the text, but also music and the way that it can pull out things from the text that, you know, gives them a little bit of a deeper meaning. I love when I talk to people who are like, "Did you mean to do, or what was the significance of that?" Or, you know, things like that. Because that stuff really matters to me. I want to make sure it's not just music for the sake of music, but I'm setting it to music in a way that is excellent and causes people to think maybe further and deeper than just reading it on the page. So.
Yeah. Is the corner room, is that almost mostly a solo act, or are you bringing others in from the church to play other instruments or be a part of that in some way?
So I do all the writing, and I try and do as much as I can. But again, I mentioned the juggling earlier. So because I'm a juggler, I try to think about how much can I get done here in the studio, in the scope of a day at the church. So I try and do as much as I can. I play keys, I play several stringed instruments. So, you know, anything I can do on my own from a time perspective, I just try to knock it out. There's a bass player in Nashville named Byron House. He's played for years on the stuff. Got to work with a guy named Andy Leftwich. He's played fiddle with Ricky Skaggs and several other bluegrassy type groups. He's played on some of the things. Who else? Oh, what's the guy's name? He's a dobro player, and I can't think of his name now. Just lost it. But anyway, yeah, it's fun to get to work with people like that. And then another thing I love to do, there's so much talent around Birmingham, and I have other people that are leading music in churches, and so I've invited people to come and sing on these projects before, especially on the Psalms, because, you know, the Psalms are so diverse in terms of just their nature, the thematic nature and the variety in the Psalter. So might as well have some variety in the type of voices we're hearing. So I like that idea of kind of bringing the community together a little bit in the studio and on these projects.
The Act of Congress, I told you I went to school in Nashville, Tennessee. My favorite band when I was there was a band called Nickel Creek. And if you've ever heard of that, like Nickel Creek and Act of Congress, like there's a lot of crossover there. And so if you've ever heard of Nickel Creek, or if you like them, you'll like Act of Congress. So you want to check them out. When you're going into, you know, writing, are you, you said you're doing word for word, are you, which translation are you using? I think I heard you do King James, but are you doing different ones?
So I'm strictly English Standard Version. That's the church we use here. That's the translation we use at church. So that's just what I naturally use.
Okay. All right. And then like when you're thinking about that, are you trying to build a melody first that you then put the words on top of, or what's your general process there?
There's an element, you know, where a pastor, well, I've never preached a sermon before, but I imagine the creative process for a pastor to take a text and just kind of immerse himself in it, study it, get an idea of what it means, what it is, if there's sections and things like that, how am I going to creatively communicate this in a sermon. I think I have a similar process to that, where I spend a lot of time just with the text and reading it. I'll use Psalm 8 as an example. There are actually some of the Psalms where you have a repeated chorus, if you will. So Psalm 8 is one of those, "O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth," happens at least twice, if not three times. I think it's twice. And so I'm looking for things like that. What are the repeated sections that could function kind of as a chorus that we kind of continue to come back to this main idea? What else? That's where I kind of start. It's just kind of an understanding of the passage. And then what really helps me, when you're doing word for word, again, there's not really any meter or rhyme. And so you're having to figure out a way to cleverly and as smoothly as possible. Sometimes you're cramming as many words as you can into a block of space. But, you know, just thinking about, before I start thinking about that, having a form for the song. So, you know, I like to use what's familiar to people. People are pretty accustomed to like a verse, pre-chorus, chorus, verse, pre-chorus, chorus, bridge, chorus, chorus. That's sort of the thing. That's kind of like an extended song form. And so if I have each of those sections defined, then I can take, I've got this little volume of the Psalms, and it's all written in pencil. I've just marked it up. But it's, you know, I'm trying to figure out what all the sections are for the song, what the chorus, what's the main idea. So the form also really helps me, because if I've established that these three verses are going to be a verse section, I know how much space and time I have to fit them in before we've got to get to the next part. So part of it's kind of math, and then you kind of have to kind of creatively think about the way to squeeze the melody in and the words in. And then the fun, what I love is just once the main instruments are recorded, I love vocal day, because the songs just start kind of coming alive. When it comes time to track the vocal, you've got hopefully most of the instruments are done, and then it's time to kind of infuse some life into this text. And I love background vocals, and harmony adds so much just to creating mood and these arrangements too. So
yeah, I think that's really neat, being able to kind of find the form of the song before you jump into that. I didn't really prep you for this, but I'm curious if you can share, you know, one way. Let me see if let me back up. One of the things I've noticed with music in general is that music by itself, God has designed us to be moved by music. I can listen to Yo-Yo Ma play the cello, and like, it's one of the few things that can make me cry, right? And mm-hmm. and that by itself is not a worship song. It's not, you know, it's not something that is spiritual or biblical necessarily. And I don't think that's a bad thing, but I think sometimes, you know, our worship songs can pull much more from that side than it can from the actual depth of theology and the words that are being sung. And so I think it's really cool when you've got both of those working in tandem, like music that really tugs at the heartstrings with words that have true depth and meaning. So for you, as you've gone through and done this, what, if anything, have you experienced personally in terms of just like some new view of this psalm, or some transformation that has happened because you've had to spend so much time with this particular music, or this something moved you and all that? Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I think there's a personal and a corporate application I'm thinking of when I think about that question. So the personal, I think, and I'm in my office right now. This is where I record all the songs. I mean, there have been some times on the last Psalms album, I recorded a version of Psalm 88. And I've always been intrigued by that psalm, because there's seemingly no resolution. You know, it ends as my companions have become darkness. Like it's pretty grim. But the psalmist is pouring his heart out to the Lord. The whole psalm is to him. He's still communicating to him. And I it was one of those moments. The arrangement is very simple. It's just piano and vocal, and that's it. And I got into, you know, a minute into the song, and just the beauty of the tune, which actually is an Irish tune, it's from a song called "The Parting Glass," and I was very intrigued by it because there was a very somber quality to it. It's in a major key, but it's kind of a somber mood. I was like this is perfect. So I had to figure out how to meld the two together. I had to stop and just wept. I left the room and just wept because it everyone's felt that way at some point in their life. Everybody's felt the brokenness inside of them and around them, and it's overwhelming, and you feel like, you know, Lord, where are you in this? I mean, you feel kind of alone or like you're on an island somewhere. And we know that that's not true. We know that the Lord is with us all the time. But that was one of those moments where I was very moved by the music, but that also it's the truth in the lyrics at the same time. I've got one more example. So my youngest daughter, Jill, she's 7 now. She was 2, when I had her record the Isaiah 41:10 on the kids album. And yeah, she's just this tiny, tiny, tiny little person, Josh. Like, she can barely, you know, she was standing right back here, and I was here at the computer, and I look back and I can't even see her because the microphone's huge, you know, like her head, I can't even see her, but I see her, she finishes the take, and then she peeks around the microphone, and I see her head, you know, but that little voice reminding me. I still listen to that, and as a 40-year-old man, I'm just brought to tears and moved to tears because, well, I'm biased. It's my daughter, and it's the sweetest thing ever.
It's
and
your
it will
daughter.
Always be sweet and beautiful. But at the same time, the truth is enormous, and the comfort that there is in God being with us in the all the time, even in the really, really tough stuff. So I think those are a couple personal examples of, yes, being moved by the truth of the lyrics and kind of the beauty of the music. And on a corporate level, I've become interested in some of these psalms. Most of these psalms, I don't recommend singing them in your church. Like, they're just not meant for congregational singing. There's too much going on. I actually tried it one time and it did not go well. So I wouldn't recommend that. But some of these shorter ones that were on the kids album, we sing those all the time at my church. This is straight from the Bible. And we're singing truths like Romans 8, 38 and 39. You know, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ. I mean, we're singing those truths together straight from the Bible. So I'm really interested in that intersection of corporate worship and scripture songs. I think it can be done, but I don't know. I I'm still trying to figure that one out. It's really hard, but it's so moving when our whole congregation is singing scripture together.
I can understand that, where it probably makes it a little bit harder to sing all together, but it, whenever there is something that fits like that, it is really neat to have everybody together singing scripture and doing mm-hmm. that. Well, Adam, thank you so much for your time. I want to leave it open just in case there's something else you wanted to add or something you felt like you wanted to share. You're welcome to do so, but if not, that's fine as well.
Yeah, I'll just plug this. So we have a website. Yeah. You can find all of our music on Spotify and Apple Music and YouTube and all the places. If you're a musician, we actually have lead sheets and chord charts on our website. You can find those in the store section for each project. Isaiah 53 and 1 Corinthians 13 actually have the string scores and the so you can if you wanted to do those at your church, you could purchase those. They're beautiful, beautiful arrangements. I did not write them. The 1 Corinthians 13, I worked with a guy named Don Hart, who's a stellar arranger composer in Nashville. And then Isaiah 53 was with Jared Hashik is his name, and he's in Australia, but just does some beautiful, beautiful, beautiful work. So anyway, if you're a musician, check that out on our website. I'm working on a new project right now. The kids record is one that I continually, people are just like, we love listening to this. Even adults are like, we love the kid record. So I'm working on another one of those right now, and hopefully we'll have that finished end of spring, early summer. So just excited about sharing some more scripture songs, and would love to do an Advent project down the road. That's kind of rattling around in my brain. And of course, there's tons more Psalms to do. So, just Josh, I appreciate you taking some time. You've been very patient with me. It's taken me several reschedules to make this happen. So I appreciate you having me on and letting me share about our ministry. And it's just been a joy to be with you.
A special thank you to Adam for taking his time to share with us. It really is. The music that they produce is top of the line, such great quality, wonderful music, so fun to listen to. So if you haven't done that, I'm going to leave links, not just to their YouTube channel and their website, but also to the music on Spotify and Apple Music, so that you can go ahead and start listening to that and see what it is that we're even talking about, because it's a fantastic way to memorize scripture. That is one of the easiest ways, as a matter of fact, for children and adults alike to memorize scripture, is to put it to song. And they've got some great music, particularly around the Psalms, but I love their 1 Corinthians 13 as well. So go listen to that. And may the Lord bless you as you continue to dig into His Word. God bless.